marching as to war with the cross of Jesus going on before. Christ the royal master leads against the foe, forward into battle, see his banners go. Onward, Christian soldiers, marching as to war, with the cross of Jesus going on before. At the sign of triumph, Satan's host doth flee. On the Christian soldiers, on to victory. Hell's foundation quiver at the shout of praise. Brothers, lift your voices, loud your anthems raise. Onward, Christian soldiers, marching as to war, with the cross of Jesus going on before. Like a mighty army moves the church of God. Brothers, we are treading where the saints have trod. We are not divided, all the body we, one in hope and doctrine, one in charity. Onward, Christian soldiers, marching as to war, with the cross of Jesus going on before. Onward then, ye people, join our happy throng, blend with your voices in the triumph song. Glory, Lord, and honor unto Christ the King. This through countless ages men and angels sing. Onward, Christian soldiers, marching as to war, with the cross of Jesus going on before. That wasn't exactly right, but we got through it. Sure missed that piano. Serve the Lord with gladness. Serve the Lord with gladness in our works and ways. Come before his presence with our songs of praise. Unto him, our Maker, we would pledge anew life's supreme devotion to service true. Serve him with gladness, enter his courts with song, to our Creator true praises belong. Great is his mercy, wonderful is his name. We gladly serve him, his great love proclaim. Serve the Lord with gladness, thankful all the while, for his tender mercy, for his loving smile. blessed truth enduring, always just the same. We will serve with gladness and praise his name. Serve him with gladness, enter his courts with song, to our Creator true praises belong. Great is his mercy, wonderful is his name. We gladly serve him, his great love proclaim. Serve the Lord with gladness, this shall be our theme. As we walk together in his love supreme, listening, ever listening for the still small voice, his sweet will so precious will be our choice. Serve him with gladness, enter his courts with song, to our Creator true praises belong. Great is his mercy, wonderful is his name. We gladly serve him, his great love proclaim. Now, Miss Kinley Smith.
Thank you, Kenley. Such a beautiful voice. And we're blessed to have her share that with us. Good morning. You know, I got asked a few years ago what one of my all-time favorite places to spend time was. And I said, it's by the water. It's anywhere where there's a body of water, I love to be. And it's one of the reasons why I love Southern Illinois so much, because it doesn't take long going in any direction to wind up at a body of water. Whether that's a river or a creek or a lake or a little pond out on my property, there's water everywhere around us. You know, one of the things I love so much about the water is the calming effect. You're out in peace and quiet. You soak in God's creation and just the awesome power that is our Creator. This past week, I had the opportunity to go out and spend some time at the water's edge and just read through and study through the scriptures that God wanted and placed on my heart. And as I'm out there and I'm taking in God's creation, I'm starting to notice the leaves. Now, I've driven down the road several times over the last couple of weeks, and I've noticed the leaves are changing and all the beautiful colors bouncing across the sky. But there was something about this week. There was something about watching the leaves changing and watching how that bounces, the reflection is bouncing off the water, that just kind of, it set my heart at ease. It set my mind at ease. And I started to think about all the different seasons that we have in a calendar year. Start thinking about how spring and summer and fall and winter, and how each and every one of these seasons brings with it a sense of beauty, an awe-ness with it. But every single one of these seasons also brings with it a set of challenges, a set of things we have to navigate through. And just like these seasons in nature, our lives go through seasons. Seasons of prosperity, seasons of joy, seasons of celebration, seasons of change, seasons when we feel like we're distant, seasons where we feel dry, seasons of disappointment, seasons of discouragement. We struggle with various things in our lives. But when you look at nature, when you look at the world around us, one of the things that you see is that it's constantly on the move. Whether you're looking at the plants or the water or the animals, it's always on the move. They're always changing. They're always adapting. They're always trying to gather the necessities that they need in order to be able to function or to be able to thrive and survive in their environment. And we're not that different from that, because as we go through our lives, we're constantly changing. We're constantly growing. We're changing jobs. We're changing locations that we live in. We're changing homes. We're changing, constantly growing and trying to grab a hold of the necessities that we need, the knowledge and the skills that we need in order to survive in our life, in order to get through these various seasons that approach. And as Christians, never is this more important than in our walk with God. Because we're going to go through seasons of trials. We're going to go through seasons where Satan is going to throw everything he can at us to try to throw us off track. And we need to be ready for it. We need to be prepared on how to stand against Satan and his forces, how to battle against this spiritual attack that's coming. You know, we have those seasons of prosperity where everything seems to be good and it's great, and we're able to bless God and praise God for all the blessings that He has given us. But it's hard when things are going against you to be able to remember those blessings. And what we're going to do over the next few weeks is we're going to be in Ephesians chapter 6 at the back end of it, which is verses 10 through 20. And we're going to see how God, number one, never, ever forsakes us. He never leaves us alone to fight these battles. He always is standing there. And number two, He always gives us the tools that we need to be able to do what He has called us to do, which is to stand up in face of the opposition and share the gospel message with a very broken and very hurting world. He has called us out of that brokenness, out of our sinfulness, and set us apart, and now is asking us to go back into that world and share the love and the grace that we have been given. And He tells us over in the Great Commission that I will be with you always, even to the end of the age. He will never forsake us. He will never leave us alone. Turn with me in your Bibles, if you will, over to the book of Ephesians, chapter 6. And as you're turning there, what I want to do is I kind of want to give you a little context for where we are in Paul's letter to the Ephesians. So Paul was in the city of Ephesus for about 3 years, ministering to and loving on these people. Now, the city of Ephesus is a big commercial hub. It's a big religious hub. Think of the big cities around us, and now you have Ephesus. And Paul is going to them, and he's loving on them, and he's sharing the gospel message with them, and he is building a church, and then later on, he finds himself imprisoned. And he's writing to the people of Ephesus to talk about a couple of things that he has seen going on. Number one, he has seen division among the people. And so he warns them about unity. He talks about how they should be unified in Christ. They to come together as a body, knowing what they have been given through Christ and how they have been brought in to the family. And that's the beginning of his letter. And in the middle part of his letter is how are we supposed to take that unity and live in our different relationships, in our marriages, with our children, with our family members, with our friendships, with our co-workers. How are we supposed to live unified in Christ in these various relationships? And then we come to the end of his letter, which is where we're going to focus over the next few weeks. Ephesians chapter 6, starting at verse 10, it says, "Finally, be strengthened by the Lord and by His vast strength. Put on the full armor of God so that you can stand against the schemes of the devil. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this darkness, against evil spiritual forces in the heavens. For this reason, take up the full armor of God, so that you may be able to resist in the evil day, and having prepared everything, to take your stand. Stand, therefore, with truth like a belt around your waist, righteousness like armor on your chest, and your feet sandaled with readiness for the gospel of peace. In every situation, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Pray at all times in the Spirit with every prayer and request, and stay alert with all perseverance and intercession for all the saints. Pray also for me, that the message may be given to me when I open my mouth to make known with boldness the mystery of the gospel. For this I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I might be bold enough to speak about it as I should." Every single one of us is dealing with some kind of a struggle, some kind of a battle in the physical realm. Every single one of us are experiencing challenges and struggles in our workplaces, in our marriages, in our relationships with our children, in relationships with our parents, in our friendships. We're struggling with different addictions that have grabbed a hold of us or of someone that we love. We're dealing with various emotional baggage, various emotional damage that we have carried through our life that we're constantly dealing with, of anxiety or depression or hopelessness or feeling like we're unlovable. We're feeling distant from God. And all of these things that we are struggling with are the forces of evil. These are the things in which Satan is trying to grasp his foothold. He's sitting back and he's looking and he's going, how can I strategize? What methods can I use to attack? How can I win the day? How can I knock you off the track God has put you on? How can I overpower? Now, Satan fools himself, because I'm going to give you a little bit of a spoiler alert. I've looked at the end, and he loses. God wins. But that doesn't stop him from trying. Because if he can try to knock us off track, if he can try to get in these gaps and start dwelling inside of ourselves and focusing on our struggles, then we lose sight of God. We lose sight of the blessings that he has given us. And we wallow in this season of dryness. And what happens is we start attacking each other. We start to blame each other and say, well, they're the reason for my discomfort. They're the reason for my struggles. If they hadn't said this or done this, I wouldn't be in the position I'm in. And we start to attack each other. And that's how Satan starts to win. He starts to create divisions. And he's done it in our world, and he's doing it in our churches. All you have to do is look, and you will see it. He creates division amongst the churches, and amongst the churches themselves, and in amongst the church body. And Paul is seeing this, and he's writing to the people at Ephesus and going, look, unity is important. Unity is where you pull yourself together as one body. You stand as one strong force against Satan. And you cannot do that on your own. You have to have the power of God. You have to stand firm in what you have already been given through Christ. He's explaining this idea that we need to be ready for the spiritual battle that's coming. We need to be prepared for what Satan is going to throw at us, because he is going to try everything. And we have to take the location of the battle, and we have to remove it from the physical realm and change the location of it. Move it to the spiritual realm where it belongs. And our weapon in warfare is the gospel. That is our weapon. That is how we stand against and fight in the spiritual battle, is the gospel. And what better weapon could you ask for? But changing the location is important. Think about an eagle and a snake. Now, if the eagle is wanting to defeat the snake, it knows instinctively he can't do it on the ground. Because on the ground, the snake is going to be successful. On the ground, the snake is going to be able to twist and turn and clip the wings of the eagle. And he's going to be able to conquer him on his turf. If the eagle wants to be successful, he has to change the location. So he swoops down, he picks up the snake, and he takes it to a different location, one in which the eagle is successful, one in which the snake can twist and turn all at once, but there's nothing to grab a hold of. There's nothing to sink its teeth into. And the eagle squishes the life out of the snake. But it's by changing the location of the battle that the eagle becomes successful. If we don't change the location of the battle from looking at it as an earthly perspective, the greatest enemy that we have, looking at Satan, the greatest enemy that we have, the fact that it's nothing of flesh and blood, we're not going to be effective. We have to change the location in order to gain victory. Otherwise, all the little victories that we claim, all the little victories that we experience, they're just going to be short-lived. But we change the location and the ultimate victory comes. The ultimate battle is won. Paul starts off in verse 10, finally be strengthened by the Lord, by His vast strength. This is not on ourselves. This is only through God. Now that word finally means therefore. Therefore. So in order for there to be a therefore, there has to be something it's following. Therefore this, do this. Well, what is the this? When we look earlier in the chapter, what we see in the book, what we see is because of Christ, because of the power that we have been given, because of the fact that Christ came and died for our sins, because of the fact that we have the same power that raised Him from the dead. By the way, He defeated Satan. He defeated death. We have that power living inside of us. And because of that, we should live our relationships the way we do. Loving on each other. And because of that, we should be able to stand strong in the Lord. Because we know what He's given us. We know what we have because of Him. And because of that, stand strong in the Lord. Not on your own abilities, not on your own capabilities, not on your own gifts, not on your own views, but on the Lord and on His strength. Put on the full armor of God so that you can stand against the schemes of the devil. Now, the first sentence in there in verse 10 is strengthened by the Lord. This is something that has already been given. But then as you go into verse 11 and 12, it's more of things we need to put on. Things that we have to physically remind ourselves every single day to put on. We have to realize who we are in Christ and put that on. We have to say, God, help me to be the man, woman, and child that You've created me to be. And start off our day putting on the knowledge that we have. We've already got a wonderful, wonderful tool, a wonderful weapon. But now we have to put something. Something has to be an action from us. And so put on the full armor of God so that you can stand against the schemes of the devil. Now that word schemes is kind of interesting. If you look back at the original Greek language, the word that's used is methodos, which is where we get our English word method from. Now, it's easy to have somebody attacking you in physical realm, in person, and be able to say, okay, well, this is how I battle that. This is what I need to do to zig and zag to avoid their jabs. Whether it's words or actions, this is what I need to do to adjust. It's a whole other thing to fight something, fight somebody that's standing back here being the puppeteer pulling the strings. Unless you realize and identify that he's back there. Now Satan is not right up here. He's not going to come right to our face and start jabbing us. He's going to work through any division that he can. He's going to work through any individual that he can to be able to conquer the day. He's back there looking at us and going, okay, where are the wounds? Where are the life struggles? Where's the pain? Where's the anxiety? Where's the depression? Where is it that you are hurting? Where are you struggling? That's what I'm going to attack. You're struggling with your viewpoints on various things in the world. Okay, I'm going to attack there. I'm going to start twisting and turning words in order to try to capture you. He did it with Eve in the garden. Eve said, we're not allowed to touch or eat of this. And Satan pounced because he's like, well, wait a minute. Is that really what God said? No, he actually said, and starts to kind of play on her vulnerabilities, on her desires. And he's doing it with us today. He's doing it with us today because we see so many things in the world and we get ourselves wrapped up in it. We get ourselves caught up in it. We get our anger and our emotions start rising to the top. And that's where Satan comes in. And he's back there and he's trying to pull the strings. He's scheming. And how do we defeat that? By standing strong in the truth. by staying strong in God. Satan's a schemer, and he is targeting you. He is targeting me. He is targeting Christians. Why is he targeting Christians? He's targeting Christians because we are the army of God. He knows that if he can divide the church, we're not a strong force. And you can honestly look at the world today, at the church today, church in general, and realize that we are not making the splash we did just a few years ago. We're not making the impact that we did just a few years ago. Why? Because of divisions inside the church. Because of divisions inside the local bodies. Because of divisions inside of our family units. And when that is happening, how can you come together as a strong force? Satan knows that. He has a strategy for you and for everyone that you love, for everyone that you know. And from the very, very beginning, we have to understand he is our true enemy. It's not the person standing in front of us. It's not the person who we disagree with. It's not the person who we have an argument with. It is not flesh and blood. It is the demonic forces that are taking root inside that's coming out. That is our enemy. And we combat that with the truth. We combat it by sharing the gospel message with our neighbors, with our friends, with our family. We share the gospel message by realizing that we are all broken. We are all lost. We are all hurting. You got struggles, so do I. You've got pain in your life, so do I. We realize we're not each other's enemies. And once we realize that, the love of Christ can be shared. The love of God can pour into people's lives. But if we don't realize that, if we don't focus on where the battle needs to be, if we don't realize that Satan is our worst enemy, if we don't realize that there's a spiritual battle going on inside each and every one of us, every single moment of every single day, then what's going to happen is we're going to end up losing ground. And we're going to start retreating. And the churches will never grow. And people will not come to hear the gospel message. But when we stand firm and strong and say, bring it on. That the best you got? Bring something else. Because I'm standing strong with my brothers and sisters and I'm standing strong in Christ. Bring it on, Satan. What happens is we advance and Satan retreats. The light goes into the darkness. Darkness scatters. And the only thing that will ever, ever change this world, the only thing that will ever change anybody, the only thing that will ever defeat the demons inside of us is love. And it's God's love. But you can't do that looking at the exterior. A few weeks ago, my family and I, we got the opportunity to do something we've never done before. We went and picked corn for the first time ever. In Texas, we got corn, but when I say corn, I'm talking corn. You know, here we've got like, I don't know, mountains, and we call them corn stalks. We've never done this before. Now, I can go out onto a ranch, and I can say that'd be a good steak right there, because that's what we have in Texas. Here we don't have that. We have corn. And so we got a chance. We're like, all right, let's experience this. And so we went out, and while we're out, Bruce and Jackson, they're teaching us how to pick the corn. And how you pull some of this back, and you stick your fingernail in it, and it squirts the juice everywhere, and you got to be careful to hold it at a right angle because it'll come flying at you. But you put that fingernail in there, and when you do it and you see the juice, you know it's good. But you know you can't see the juice from the exterior. You can't look at the exterior of that corn or with the the stalk over it. You can't look at that kernel of corn and know it's good. You have to get to the inside to see the goodness. You know, when it comes to us, it's the same way. I can't look at you and go, you're good. I can't look at you and go, I know what's inside. Until I get to know you, until I start to pull back the layers and start to realize what's at the core. And then I know, is it God or is it Satan at work? Do you have struggles that need to come out? Do you have turmoil in your life? Have you ever been treated with genuine love? I don't see it until I pull back the layers. I want to give you an example of something that took place this past week, or 2 weeks. And many of you in here know what I'm talking about. Just up the road in West Frankfort, there's an issue that's on the table of a little girl who's identifying as a little boy and wants to go in and is allowed to go in the locker room of the boys. And it's created a turmoil. It's created an issue. And on Wednesday night of this past week, there was a school board meeting in which it was packed with people who showed up to voice their concerns, their opinions, to voice whether it was right or whether it was wrong. In all the different realms, we've got this young girl who's feeling this way, we've got the people who are allowing it, and we've got a young man who is brave enough to stand up and go, this is wrong. And all of these facets of this situation are under question. All of this is struggles. And over listening to the people talk, and expressing. And there was a lot of people in that room. It was standing room only. There were three people that spoke that caught my attention. Number one was Larry Miller. Larry Miller got up. He was the first to speak. And he addressed the school board with respect and with admiration and with prayer. He said, look, you have a choice to make. And whatever decision you make, it's going to cost you. There's going to be people in our world that are going to be angry no matter which direction they go on any piece of it. And Larry addresses that. And he says, look, none of us in this room envy you. We respect you. We're praying for you. He treated them like human beings who have a tough decision to make. And he said, I'm going to pray for you as I have been. Then there was a youth pastor in the area who got up and was very emotional. And he shared about how it's wrong. It's wrong to let something like this take place. And he referenced how Jesus left the 99 to go after the one. To love on the one, to share truth with the one, to pour into the... He never neglected the 99. But he went and he loved on the one to bring the one back into the fold, to make the fold whole again. And he said, you know what? This one, this little girl is struggling inside. She is broken inside. And we have to love on her. We have to shower her with the truth. We have to be there to understand what is inside. We have to pull back the layers in order to know what is driving this. And I guarantee it's Satan at work. And he said, we cannot be so blinded by everything else that we neglect the one. And then there were two students that walked down. And what they said hit me hard. And what the experience that they had was heartbreaking. Two students walked down. And what they said was that their friend, and we can only assume that it was this girl, what they said was that their friend is afraid. Their friend is being severely bullied and ridiculed over what is taking place. Listen, I'm not saying that what this little girl is doing is right, because Scripture is very clear on the definition, man, woman, God created us a certain way. Deuteronomy 22 talks about putting on clothing. It's wrong. But what is worse is to bully and ridicule somebody, especially a child, who is reacting to this, who's going through issues. We don't know what she's dealing with in life. We don't know the hurt that she's gotten. Maybe she feels abandoned. Maybe the ones who are supposed to love her more than anything in this world have abandoned her, and she is reaching. She is screaming for help. And she's being bullied. And on top of that is these two girls are talking about their friend. There are people in the room booing them for speaking up. I'm not saying it's right what they're defending. I'm not saying it's right what this girl did. But I am saying that what people were doing in the room was just as bad. We cannot treat people that way. When we do, we give in to the demonic attacks. We give in to Satan. Listen, as a society, we are oftentimes wondering why people that are struggling with emotional distress, why people that are battling depression, why people that have suicidal thoughts, why people that are hurting so much don't speak up. Why don't they speak up and get the help they needed? Why didn't they say something when we could have helped them? Well, I'll tell you why. Because they're afraid of speaking up. Because when they do, it happens. When they do, they get ridiculed. They get bullied. When they do, we shun them. We shame them. We criticize them. Who in this room would speak up after experiencing that? Or somebody that you love, that you know, experiencing that? I'm willing to bet not a single one of us would. Because we wouldn't want that coming on us. Listen, God created every man, woman, and child distinctly and uniquely, and we are called as Christians to go out and love them. We are called to be different than this world. We are called to go, you know what? You are not my enemy. Satan is my enemy. Let me share the truth of the gospel with you. And let me love on you. It's what Jesus tells us over in John chapter 13, verses 34 and 35. I give you a new command. Love one another, just as I have loved you. You are also to love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. You want to know how to stand strong against Satan, against the spiritual warfare that is going on in this world? We stop criticizing. We stop shaming others for their actions. And we peel back the layers. We take time to go, who are you? What is inside? What is your life experiences? Listen, all these struggles that we go through, the depression, the anxiety, all of these various things, I am not discounting them, because there are real reasons why they happen. Sometimes it's genetics. Sometimes it's life experiences. Sometimes it's something chemical imbalance that's going on inside. But there is a force that is behind the scenes that is more powerful than anything like that, and that is Satan. And the only way that he will ever be defeated is by the power of the gospel, by the power of God living through us into the lives of our brothers and sisters, into the lives of our neighbors, and sharing the truth with them. What should happen is somebody should embrace this little girl and various people like her in our world and say, let me show you the truth. Let me love on you. Let me help you understand what is right and what is wrong. But what we do is we shun them. Satan wins small victories through division. And no amount of external pressure, no amount of criticism, no amount of power from the external is ever going to change what is on the inside. The only thing that will is love working from the inside out. Saying, I love you. And I'm here for you. The demonic forces start to flee. Because when light is present, darkness is not. When light is present, darkness is not. When love is shown, the hatred, the issues that we're struggling with, the battle, the shame, the depression, the loneliness flees because we see love. We receive love. Let me put it this way. When you get a cold, you do not stop the cold, get rid of the cold by attacking the runny nose, by attacking a symptom. You have to go to the virus. You have to kill off the virus that's causing all the symptoms. And the virus is a demonic force called Satan. How do we defeat a virus like Satan? We stand strong in the truth. We stand strong in our knowledge of who God is and what He has done for us. And by sharing that with everybody we can. That is how you defeat the virus. That is how you tell Satan, sit down, your time is done. That is how we advance God's kingdom. We take this into the world. And we say, you're hurting. I see it. I feel it. I got something for you. You're looking for love? Here it is. You're looking for truth? Here it is. You're looking for comfort? Here it is. You're looking for compassion? Here it is. You're looking for belonging? Here it is. You're looking for anything and everything in your life to make yourself whole again? This is the only thing that will do it. And we take this into the world. Satan attacks by exposing our weaknesses and our vulnerabilities. And God gives us the power to work through them. He loves us in spite of them. And He sends us out to love others in the same way. The church is the people of God on the mission of God for the glory of God. Pure and simple. The church is the people of God on the mission of God for the glory of God. And He has created us as a family, to go out and do it. So let me ask you this. Are you ready? Are you ready to walk into the fire? Are you ready to stand up and say, Satan, sit down? Because enough is enough. If you are, hold on tight. Because God's ready. And He's going to work through us to advance His kingdom. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank You so much for the ways that You love us. God, would you provide opportunities for us to see past the physical realm, to be able to see what's going on. God, you provide everything we need, every tool that we could ever ask for. You provide that in our lives. You have called us to not conform to this world, but to be out of this world. And God, sometimes we forget that before we welcomed you into our life, we were in that position. We were in sin. We were wandering. We were lost. We were broken. We were hurting, and we were looking for something to grab a hold of, something to make us whole again. And somebody, somewhere in our journey, shared the gospel message with us. And we started to realize who you are and what you have for us. God, help us to not forget that. Help us to actually use that and to go out into this battle and to say, you know what, I've been in your shoes. Now, our experiences may be different, but the feelings are the same. Help us to remember that and help us to take your message of love and grace into this world. God, we stand strong and we stand firm in you. And we know that that's the only way that your kingdom is going to advance, is by your power, your love, your grace, your mercy, working through us on the front lines. And you've called us to go to the front lines. God, help us to not wait another moment, but to get up and go into this battle. God, if there's anybody here that is struggling, if there's anybody here that is saying, you know what, I need something more in my life because I am hurting. I am dealing with an addiction. I'm dealing with depression. I'm dealing with something emotional. I'm dealing with something in my life, and I have got to lay that at the feet, and I have got to take on the armor of God. I have got to feel your love and your presence, God. Now, if there's anybody here that's feeling that way, I just pray that they come forward here in another moment and just be able to hit their knees at the altar and just pray or say, Pastor, I need some prayer. God, don't let us wait another moment. And we ask all of this in your name. Amen.